So I want to share with you 23 years of weight loss advice in 10 minutes. In 23 years of working in the area of fitness and nutrition, I believe I have heard it and seen it all. More importantly, I have developed some hacks and some tricks that I think will help you overcome yo-yo dieting if you've struggled. Maybe you are struggling with type 2 diabetes, hypertension, high blood pressure, and all the dysfunctionalities that come from carrying extra weight, then I believe that this video is going to serve you well. So don't go anywhere because I'm gonna give you some nuggets. More importantly, I wanna answer some of those questions that most people struggle with. And so here's 23 years of weight loss advice in 10 minutes. The question that I get the most often is, JT, what's the most efficient an effective diet? And I would say that the one that you can sustain forever, more importantly, the one in where you don't have to exert a ton of energy in order to make things happen. So you ask, well, what is that? Well, that is a plan that has a multidisciplinary approach. Nutrition can be very, very tricky, and it's not just about rules, but more importantly, being able to deal with the triggers, temptations, and things that come at you when you're trying to change your lifestyle. And so the habit and the lifestyle coaching is super important, on top of course, the dynamics, eat this, don't eat that. But the intrinsic reasons for staying on a program are very, very important. You need to work with a coach. You need to be on a program that understands that rules have never changed anyone, but instead that convictions are what bring lasting change. And so you need a plan with a multidisciplinary approach. You need a plan that is actually going to have a coach that understands cognitive processes. And then of course you need a sustainable dynamic that you can do for the rest of your life without exerting a ton of energy. Number two question, are carbs bad for you? If you've noticed, the vast majority of programs out there omit starchy carbohydrates. And then the question is why? Why omitting starchy carbohydrates when, you know, all foods are made by God and they should be good, right? And I would agree with that, but here's the problem. Starchy carbohydrates actually secrete more dopamine than any other macronutrient. And so even though we don't demonize food groups, we set them aside for a little bit in order to make some progress. We operate in seasons. And so we don't demonize them. We just put them aside for a little bit. We deplete glycogen storages. And then when we come back, we slowly but surely introduce those. And so carbs are not bad. They're simply, you need to know how to portion them out. You need to think about slow digesting carbs versus fast digesting carbs. Slow digesting carbs are things like brown rice, quinoa, couscous, dark pigmented fruit like blueberries, blackberries, strawberries, sweet potatoes, and then of course the fast digesting carbs with the white rice, the white bread, the pastas, and the things that most people like, right? And so carbs are not bad for you, but you need to know how to operate in seasons. More importantly, you need to choose the right ones, and you need to know how and when to reintroduce those carbs so that you can continue to move forward and you're not demonizing food groups. The next question I get all the time is, what's the most effective way to lose weight? Is it running? Right? Is that a good approach, JT? Should I just run in order to lose weight? Well, I know many people that have lost weight by running, but I can tell you it's not the most effective thing because it is actually one of the hardest things. It's hard on your body. It's hard on the collagen in your skin, specifically in your face. I don't know if you're interested in that, but for sure, if you are a runner, you're gonna start depleting some of that glycogen in your face, and then you're gonna look withdrawn, and that's not necessarily a good look. The other side to that is you need a lot of recovery time. Running is hard on your body, so you need a couple of days to recover in between versus actually walking, which walking is one of the most efficient things to lose body fat percentages in record time. It's not hard on your body, you don't need recovery time, and it depletes glycogen storages like no other form of exercise. And so I wouldn't run as a strategy to lose weight, even though it's helpful in the beginning. You can make that happen, but it's not the most sustainable way to go about it. It is hard on your body. The next question that I get is, do I need to count calories, macros, or points, JT, in order to make progress? Well, these strategies are very efficient, right? These strategies, if you're counting macros, calories, or points, you're going to be able to lose weight. You're going to be able to most likely get to your goal. But the challenge with these strategies is that there's complexity involved in them. And so if you're counting macros, for example, you have to download things like MyFitnessPal. You need to log all the food that you're gonna eat the day before into the app. And then you gotta stick to that plan, right? You have to make sure that you're sticking to every single macro and that you're categorizing every macronutrient correctly, because any slight little change can throw your macros off and easily get you into a calorie surplus. There's a lot of complexity around that. And so I would say that no, you don't need to count macros, calories, or points. There is a simple way to actually portion control, and it doesn't require you to do all these complex things like counting macros, calories, or points. And so I don't know about you, but that's good news for most people. Question number six that I have here is food addiction a real thing? JT, is it true that people can truly be addicted to anything? And the answer to that is anything that secretes dopamine becomes addictive. Dopamine is a neuroreceptor that's associated with well-being. So anytime there's adversity, there's friction in your life, anytime that you are disappointed, happy, any ups or downs, your body is going to want to get a dopamine hit. Oftentimes, the safe way to do that is through food, because the other options are way more problems with it. Like, of course, the alcohol and the drugs and the cigarettes, and the way most people mitigate emotions is too destructive. And so the safe way to generally do that is through food. And the thing I get from most people is, it's just food, JT, right? I need to eat. But the challenge is, when we start mitigating emotions with food, we become dependent on that particular drug called food. I call it the innocent drug for that particular reason. There is a way to overcome food addiction. It doesn't take very long, but you have to take all the right steps in order to overcome, put yourself into abstinence from those high insulin yielding foods. And if you do that, you can reset your brain, reset your brain's reward pathways, and overcome food addiction in a very, very effective and sustainable way. Question number seven is an interesting one. People say, you know, I saw this documentary about vegans and vegetarians. Is the vegan or vegetarian approach the most reliable way to lose weight? And I'm here to say that we have vegans and vegetarians that come on the Empty Your Bucket nutrition plan, and they do well. But being a vegan or a vegetarian oftentimes is a little bit more challenging in losing body fat percentages. Let me explain before you cringe, you roll your eyes, and you say, this guy has no idea what he's talking about. Most vegan and vegetarian proteins are starchy, okay? Most vegans and vegetarians are eating lentils, garbanzos, beans. All these are high insulin yielding foods. So yes, if you bring those in the correct portions, yes, you can lose weight, but you'll never get rid of the sugar dependencies, because remember, anytime you spike insulin, you're storing glycogen. Glycogen, aka sugar, is if you're compounding that, it's gonna be very hard to lose the weight. It's gonna come off, but slower, and even when it comes off, you'll still have those cravings and those temptations. So I see a lot of vegans and vegetarians struggling with cravings and temptations, and then they opt for all the stuff that has preservatives. So it's like they're taking out, quote unquote, one devil and adding another. So is the vegan and vegetarian approach the best approach for weight loss? I don't personally think so, but if that's your choice, there's a way to do it. I just think that it's a lot easier when you have a diet that is balanced in macronutrients. Question number eight, what are your thoughts on weight loss surgery? Man, we can go on for days and days and days on what I think about weight loss surgery. There are a lot of other options that are safer, that are more sustainable for the long run, and that actually can eradicate the problem of obesity. Now, we all know that people that get weight loss surgery lose the weight. So then you're saying, JT, well, I mean, people get on the surgery and they actually lose the weight. So what's the problem? The problem is the challenges that come afterwards, such as people that get gastric bypass oftentimes have metabolic issues later on in life. They do a number to their digestive enzymes. You see people develop reflux. You see people actually develop eating disorders after weight loss surgeries. You see some people that constantly have to purge after they eat, because their stomach cavity is so small now that anytime they eat, even if it's just a small amount, they have to go and purge. And the list goes on and on and on. Now, are there people out there that have been successful with weight loss surgery and have been able to channel their energy into proper eating and exercise? Yes, but the vast majority of people that opt for surgeries are people that are looking for a quick fix, or they've tried a bunch of things, they haven't been successful, and now they're just frustrated and they're going for the easy way out. But oftentimes that comes at the price of their health. And so I don't believe that's the best approach, but I've seen people make it work. Just a very small percentage of those people. Question number nine, could it be my hormones? Is that the reason that I'm not losing weight? This is an argument that I hear all the time from people. You know, I'm going through menopause, premenopause, some men are going through andropause, and yes, When we get to a specific age, specifically men after the age of 30 can experience andropause, which is the male version of menopause. And of course, that can slow things down significantly. Same thing for women going through menopause or premenopause. I'm gonna use an example that is kind of a harsh example, but I want you to hear me out. If you look at pictures of people in the Holocaust, okay? Very sad pictures of people in the Holocaust. No one in those pictures is overweight. Now, every single one of those people in those pictures is experiencing hormonal issues based on starvation. So my question to you is, are the hormones keeping you from losing the weight, or is it your intake? And every time I say this, people roll their eyes at me and say, oh, come on, JT. And my answer to that is, if you find the right plan, even if your hormones are slower, your reproductive hormones are not doing what they're supposed to do, but you stay consistent with the proper nutrition, the proper macro balance, you're moving in the most effective way, which is doing your power walking, you're staying consistent, you're sleeping well, you're hydrating well, you're not secreting a ton of dopamine from all these foods that you're consuming, because remember, once you bring in high insulinogenic foods, they spike dopamine. Once you spike dopamine, you get addicted to these things. Now you're having triggers, temptations. If you manage to actually stay consistent with these things, even if your hormones are not doing the right thing in that moment, guess what? Once you stay consistent with your nutrition, your hormones will fire off and start doing all the right things, because our body is a machine. And once we start feeding it the right things, we start sleeping well, hydrating well, and doing everything to take care of ourselves, things can get back on track. Now, I'm not opposed to you seeing an endocrinologist and maybe dealing with some of these challenges that you have. But the truth is that those things can work side by side. Proper nutrition, really looking after hydration, sleep, the right kind of movement, and working with a health professional, a physician that understands reproductive hormones, can be very, very helpful. We've had tons of people come on the Empty Your Bucket plan with hormonal issues. We've resolved those issues in a very, very holistic way. And so here you have it, guys, a little over 10 minutes. I wanted to give you everything that is the most kind of popular questions that I get and the questions that I've gotten in the last 23 years. And hopefully this has been helpful. More importantly, I hope that you see the light at the end of the tunnel, that you understand that when you're on the right program, when you're being held accountable to your commitments, it is a true and fast way to bring your goals to fruition. I hope to see you on the other side of the Empty Your Bucket Nutrition Plan. If that is not the case, I hope you take all of this advice that I gave you, you put it to action, you make it work for you. And if that's the case, then this video was more than worth it. My name is JT Tapias with the Empty Your Bucket Nutrition Plan. I hope you've enjoyed this video. I'll talk to you guys soon. Ciao, ciao.